Okay, so we're moving on to key number two, as George Leonard puts it, and this one is called, it's on practice, right? So the first one was instruction and getting the right instructor and the right, you know, course of action. Now it comes down to practice. So yeah, and as we talk about practice, there's a really, you know, obviously that old joke that, you know, there's a couple of Texans in a Cadillac on their way to a concert in New York City, and they're lost in the Lower East Side, and they stop to question a passerby, you know, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? And they ask, and the stranger replies, practice. Which is just, I mean, again, I'm terrible at delivering jokes, but that's so perfect. I mean, it's just, you know, it's all going to be about practice. How you practice, when you practice, how consistently you practice. What do you think about when you're practicing? How do you focus? Does your mind wander? Do you daydream a lot? Are you constantly thinking about being somewhere else instead of where you're at? So often referred to as a verb, practice, right? To practice. You know, you practice in order to learn a skill, you practice in order to improve yourself, you practice in order to get ahead, to achieve goals, etc. So as a verb, the word practice does have a place in our trajectory moving forward on the path of mastery. But we may want to think of it more as a noun, something that we possess, something that we... So, you know, for those who master's journey, it would be best to think of it as a noun, not as something you do, but something you have and are. So practice is the path on which you travel. We know that. So practice as a noun can be anything you practice on a regular basis as an integral part of your life. So ultimately, the master and the master's path are one. So when we think of it like, okay, we have to practice on a daily basis, in a verb sense, in order to ultimately become more of the noun, which is to obtain and to have these skills ultimately, right? So practice is a very cryptic topic to talk about. It's one that I have, again, hung my hat on my whole life. Whenever in doubt, practice more, almost to a fault. And it's something that I did for a long time out of fear and out of guilt. Felt guilty that I wasn't practicing enough because my parents were helping me go to school and they were struggling, and I knew they were struggling to keep me in school, and I had a lot of guilt about it, you know? So I felt like I should be studying all the time. And I did, and I worked really hard. So the motivation in the beginning was more fear-based, guilt-based, and that's not a good reason in the long run to hang your hat on. I've met students of mine that have had to, in order to continue progressing and moving forward at a high level, they had to make enemies out of the people that were around them in order to leverage themselves to get better. It's a very dicey, negative, short-term way to think about practice, and it will ultimately, you'll cut your nose off to spite your face. So be careful with that. Practice can be liberating. It can also be confining. It can also pull you into odd patterns, sequences. So when we practice, we need to practice from a very good place. Now, this is not something that George Leonard is talking about. This is what I'm picking up from Eckhart Tolle, from other people that I've been motivated, Tony Robbins again, and people of that kind of ilk, where they're geared towards really moving. You know, you want to move towards your goals of financial security, owning, there's nothing wrong with wanting to own nice things, wanting to have nice things. As long as you're willing to work for it, you're not willing to hurt other people in order to get it, I think, there's nothing wrong with working really hard because you want to buy a nice car because you love aesthetics, you know? You love good design, and that's kind of how I am. But it shouldn't be the motivating factor behind, you should have a spiritual component to your practice, as if it was a sadhana, which is a spiritual practice. You would want to make it imbued with a beautiful overall idea of what it means to practice. Make it a ceremony. Make it a process that's very individual to your heart, your soul. And when you do it with as much integrity and love and joy and peace as you can possibly muster. Now, I'm just coming out of a period where I had derailed from that myself. And I had to work through a very difficult period of negativity that was surfacing from all kinds of personal stuff that was happening in my life. And it was one of the most cryptically odd, difficult periods I've ever had to work through. But again, being on the master's journey, just even doing this podcast and training and reading and studying to do this podcast for you guys, it reconnected me with aspects that I had forgotten about, aspects that I had neglected in practice, practicing for the wrong reasons, practicing with the wrong motivations, practicing to get accolades, to get more people to know me, more people to understand who I am. Just the motivations not coming from a place of purity, a place of love, a place of authenticity, the way I want to show up, right? So unfortunately, some people may catch glimpses of that in some of the online stuff because I was going through that when I was shooting it. But I did a really admirable job, I think, overall to curb it based on what was happening in my life, which I don't really want to divulge or go into in depth. But it was incredibly difficult, incredibly, you know, kind of take you down to your to the marrow of your being, you know. So a lot of that stuff will challenge, it will percolate to the top, and it will interact with you as you your demons, your fears, your anxieties. These things are going to be present, and they're going to rear their head as you start to journey on the master's journey. You're going to be challenged by the universe. I mean, in order to get these certain accolades, these certain things that are coming your way, you have to earn them. And there's almost like a sacrifice that has to occur in order to get them. And that sacrifice could be letting go of grievances, letting go of anguish, letting go of anger, letting go of resentments. And, oh, I want to be like this person, or I want all the, you know, I want to be famous like this painter. Or I want to, you know, things that just don't really have a place. So practice is going to be key. How we practice is going to be key. So in Aikido, achieving black belt is only one more step along an endless path, a license to go on learning for as long as you live. So a lot of people in martial arts would think that once you've acquired a black belt that you've arrived, you've mastered that particular discipline, karate, Aikido, whatever it may be. Well, what George Leonard's saying is that the black belt gives you permission to start learning. It is your graduation into the real learning of that craft. That is a perception or a concept that if you were to tell someone coming into martial arts, you know, this is how it's going to be, they would probably just either leave, quit, or not even, or just not believe you, you know, would probably be more the case. Oh, he's just saying that, you know, and whatever, you know, but it's pretty interesting. I thought that was very poignant. So if you stay on the path long enough, you'll find it to be a vivid place with its ups and downs, its challenges and comforts, its surprises, disappointments, and unconditional joys. You'll take your share of bumps and bruises while traveling, bruises of the ego, as well as of the mind, body, the mind, and spirit, but it might well turn out to be the most rewarding and reliable thing in your life. So what then is a master? I think we have come to realize at the heart of the matter is practice. Mastery is staying on the path. So that is for that particular section, which is, again, I thought pretty poignant on the different processes. Practice is something that we will be doing, we need to fall in love with, and we need to do it from our heart with good intentions. That's kind of the gist of it, what I got out of that. So the next one is surrender, key number 3, and we'll be getting to that shortly.